I want to talk with you a little bit about, I say a little bit, probably going to take, might take 2 weeks. I'm going to go through this information. There's a lot of it. I'm going to go through it. If I see I'm not going to get through with most of it tonight, we'll make two sessions out of it. Most of the time it takes at least 2 weeks to teach this information. But I want to talk to you about Baal worship. In Ezekiel chapter 8, when Ezekiel goes into the temple, he has four illustrations of the apostasy of the nation Israel that causes them to be cast into the fifth course of judgment, the captivity. And they all center around the temple, how Baal worship, the apostate religion of the satanic policy of evil, has not just overtaken the people, it's literally in the temple. And they've literally amalgamated it into the temple worship of Jehovah. And this religion that's doing this, if you come with me to Revelation chapter 17, this is the religion that starts back in Genesis chapter 3 and goes all the way through to Revelation 17 and is the church of the Antichrist. In Revelation 17, he sees the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters. Now, the great whore is the religious system that we're talking about. He describes it in verse number 3. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast full of the names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. Now, I'm going to try to remember to write up here on the board some of these words that you need to kind of notice as you go through. See, he sees a woman, and she sits on a beast, and her colors are purple and scarlet. And you notice that it says that she's decked with gold and precious stones and pearls and having a golden cup in her hand. So there's gold and jewelry and a golden cup. In the worship, where you worship this woman, these colors are predominant. Gold and silver are a big issue, and a golden cup is the symbol of what she's going to do. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of the abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, comma, Babylon the Great, comma, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. This Babylon the Great, this religious system that finds its roots in Babylon, we'll look at that in a minute, is called the mother of harlots. She's the mother, but she's the mother of systems that represent her. She's the mother of harlots. There's a whole bunch of harlot systems that come out of her, but she's the mother. She's the great city. Verse 18, the woman which thou sawest is that great city which reigneth over the kings of the earth. So she's a city. And all these things about her have to do with what's there. And she reigns over the king. This system reigns over the kings of the earth from Genesis 11 all the way down to the Antichrist. It's the behind-the-scenes mystery religious system that produces all of the vain systems, all of the systems of religious apostasy all through history. So she's somebody you need to understand, and what you're seeing in Ezekiel chapter 8 is her presence in the very temple of God himself. Now come back with me to Deuteronomy 32, just to get something of an understanding of what's going on here. Deuteronomy 32 is the Song of Moses. And I said to you many times, this is actually what I would call the national anthem of the nation Israel. It starts with Israel's beginning, goes all the way through the second coming of Christ and his kingdom. Give ear, O ye heavens, and I will speak, and hear, O earth, the words of my mouth. This is for everybody. My doctrine shall drop as the rain. My speech shall distill as the dew. And as a small rain shall upon the tender herbs, and as the showers upon the grass. Because I will publish the name of the Lord. ascribe ye greatness unto our God. He is the rock. Notice that word rock is with a capital R. That's a personal pronoun. That rock is identified in this chapter and in 1 Corinthians 10 as the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the rock. His work is perfect. For all his ways are judgment, a God of truth and without iniquity. Just and right is he. That's Israel. That's the God of the Bible. They have corrupted themselves. Their spot, notice their spot, they, is not the spot of his children. They are a perverse and crooked generation. So now you've got somebody who's not the God of Israel, who's not perfect, who's not right. They're corrupting. Do ye thus requite the Lord, O foolish people and unwise? Is not he thy father that hath bought thee, hath he not made thee and established thee? He's going to chastise the apostates in the nation. Remember ye the day, remember the days of old. Consider the years of many generations. Ask thy father, and he will show thee, thy elders, and they will tell thee. When the Most High divideth the nations. Now, you remember the title, the Most High. What's that title about? Genesis 14. The Most High, the possessor of heaven and earth. When Lucifer rebelled against God, his goal was to be like the Most High. So we're talking about here God as the possessor, the ruler of heaven and earth. We're talking about the position that the adversary seeks to usurp from him. So when the Most High, the one who controls, rules, and dictates the activities in heaven and earth, divided to the nations, that's the Gentiles, their inheritance, when he separated the sons of Adam, he set the bounds of the people according to the number of the children of Israel. For the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the lot of his inheritance. Now notice what's going on. God separated Israel out from among the Gentiles. Israel is his portion. The Gentiles are not his portion. This is what Paul talks about in Acts chapter number 14, if you look over there. Acts 14, verse number 15. He's talking to the pagans at Lystra, the idol worshippers there. They say in verse 11, the gods are come down to us in the likeness of men. These are men worshiping false gods. Verse 15, Paul says, sirs, why do you these things? We also are men of like passions with you, and preach unto you that you should turn from these vanities unto the living God, which made heaven and earth, the sea and all the things that are therein, who in time past suffered all nations to walk in their own ways. So God literally, Romans chapter 1, he says he gave them over. God literally gave up the Gentiles to walk in their own ways. Chapter 17, verse number 30, that at that time, I'm sorry, in the times of this ignorance, God winked at. But now, commandeth all men to repent. Time passed, he let the Gentiles go. He turned them over to walk in their own ways. Now that's what Romans chapter 1, verse 28 is talking about. And the vanities, of course, is Romans 1, 20, 21. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations. That's the vanity of their minds. They imagined what they thought was true, was what was true. Their foolish heart was darkened, professing themselves to be wise, they became fool and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image. So they make idolatry, they're going to worship the image, the creature, more than the Creator. They develop their own religious system. So what does God do? Verse 24, God gave them all up. Verse number 26, for this cause God gave them up to these things of the flesh. But verse 28 says it a little differently. Even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind. He didn't simply give them up to it. He literally turned them over to a reprobate mind, to a worthless thinking process, to the vanities of their mind. And what he did when he divided the nations, it's more than a physical division. There is that physical. A nation is identified in Genesis 10 as borders, language, and people. That physical division. But there's more to it than that. Look back at Deuteronomy chapter 4. Hold on to Deuteronomy 32. You remember when Paul says that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against spiritual wickedness in high places? And he talks about against the principalities, the rulers of the darkness of this world. The darkness is spiritual darkness. Their heart, they're professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and their hearts were darkened. You turn off the truth, turn off the light. But there are the rulers of the darkness, these principalities and powers in the heavenly places. There's a spiritual hierarchy out here in the heavens, functions in the earth, in the spiritual realm, that are literally the rulers of the darkness of this world. Satan said, I want to be like them. I want to be the one that rules things. So he sets up a counterfeit, a counter rulership, and seeks to usurp that authority from God. And the conflict comes to a head among the nations in Genesis chapter number 11. And he literally turns, when he divides the nations at Babel, turns them over. He's literally turning them, not just dividing them, separating them physically. He's literally turning them over to the gods, the false gods. That they don't want him. So he says, okay, you don't want me, have these guys. And he literally assigns these nations, these gods to the nations. Genesis, Deuteronomy chapter 4, warning Israel about this. Verse 17, lest thou lift up thine eyes unto heaven, and when thou seest the sun and the moon and the stars, even all the host of heaven, shouldest be driven to worship them. And so, what did we see in Ezekiel 8 at the end there? They turned their back on the presence of Jehovah, turned to the east, and they were worshiping the sun. They were doing exactly what this passage is talking about. And they're going to serve them, which the Lord thy God had divided under all nations under the heavens. But when he talks about it's not talking about just worshiping the physical sun and the moon and when he talks about the host of heaven, he's talking about that heavenly host. You remember in Luke 2, the heavenly host is praising God and singing. It's talking about the angelic creation. And he literally divides to the nations these gods that they prefer over him. And then he says, I'll create me a nation, and my portion among the nations will be this nation I create. I'll be their God, and they'll be my people. And you'll see in them what it's like to have me as God, and you'll see what it's like to have all these false gods, these pretenders. When I say false gods, it doesn't mean they aren't real angelic creatures. They're just gods with a little g. They're not the God. They're professing to be the God. So they're liars. Now, if you go to Genesis chapter 6, I'm sorry, chapter 11, when this takes place, you see that in at the Tower of Babel, there is a religious connection as well as political. Genesis 11, the whole earth was of one language and one speech. And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. And they said one to another, let us make brick. We're not going to take what God did, we'll make our own. Burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime had they for mortar. And they said, go to, let us build us a city. That's what Cain did. Every city from Genesis 4 all the way to Revelation 20 in the Bible that's built by man is built in rebellion against God. God told him to scatter. What he told Moses, Noah, I'm sorry, Genesis 9, just like he told Cain. They're going to build a city, a political institution in the earth, so they can have a name and a permanent dwelling place, lest we be scattered upon the face of the earth. But notice they don't just build a city, they build a tower. They build a high place. Now we're going to look at verse after verse where you'll see these Baal worshipers are building. They build high places, elevated places, whose top may reach unto heaven. We're going to build this high place, and we're going to do some spiritual things that are going to allow us to get to heaven, connect to the gods. That's the beginning of the separation of the clergy and the laity that winds up being condemned in Revelation chapter 3. We're going to set them up, and we're going to have this high place to worship. So there's this spiritual element connected with it. And if you look back, you look down at verse number 9, therefore in the name of it is called Babel. So the name of the place there is Babel. But chapter 10, verse number 8, Cush begat Nimrod, and he began to be a mighty one in the earth. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Wherefore it is said, even as Nimrod, the mighty hunter before the Lord. Now watch, and the beginning of his kingdom was Babel. Something began at Babel. Something began in rebellion against the God of the Bible at Babel. There is a religious, not just a political system, but a religious system that is going to reign over the cities, the political element in the earth. So there is a spiritual thing going on back here in the background that's the rulers of the darkness of this world. Now come back to Deuteronomy 32. It's into that kind of a context that he places the nation Israel. So there's a spiritual battle as well as a physical battle going on here. Deuteronomy chapter 32. If you go down to verse number 12. So the Lord alone did lead him, and there was no strange god with him. Israel didn't have any of these foreign gods. They only had Jehovah. That's why Moses writes them in Exodus, the Lord our God is the God of gods. Jehovah is the Elohim of Elohim, Hebrew. He's the God, big G, of the gods, little g. The little g gods are, the word God is it's the idea of being the top ruler. Well, God gave positions of rulership to angelic hosts in different positions. They're delegated rulers. But Jehovah is the Most High. He's the top guy that gives the orders. He's the God with the big G. They're little g gods. Israel doesn't have a little g god. They got the big G god. That's what Jehovah is. So the Lord alone, Jehovah alone, did lead him. And there was no strange god with him. He made him ride on the high places of the earth. If you come down to verse number 15. But Jeshurun, and that's a name for Israel, waxed fat and kicked. Thou art waxed fat, thou art grown thick, thou art covered with fatness. When that kind of prosperity came, what did he do? He forgot God, which made him, and lightly esteemed the rock of his salvation. They provoked him to jealousy with strange gods. With abominations provoked they him to anger. We're reading that in Ezekiel chapter 6 and chapter 8, how they've provoked him. The image of jealousy in Ezekiel. How did they do it? They sacrificed unto devils, not to God. To gods, little g's, to whom they knew not, to the new gods that came newly up, whom their fathers feared not, of the rock, big R, that begat thee, thou art unmindful. So they're going to go out here and they're going to sacrifice. They're going to have worship services where they sacrifice. They're going to have sacrifices in their worship where they're worshiping the wrong god. Verse number 18, though, the rock that begat thee, thou art not mindful. Verse 30, how should one chase 1,000 and two put 10,000 to flight, except their rock, Jehovah, had sold them and the Lord had shut them up? For their rock, notice that's with a little r, their rock is not our rock. This false religion is being built on a rock, but the rock that it's built on is not the right rock. It's a pretender. They're built on a rock, but it's not Jehovah. For their vine is the vine of Sodom and the fields of Gomorrah. Their grapes are grapes of gall. Their clusters are bitter. Their wine is the poison of dragons and the cruel venom of ass. Notice, in their sacrifices and in their worship of the rock, they're using wine, they're using grapes, they're using the fruit of the vine. Verse 14. Butter and keen milk of sheep with fat of lambs, rams of the breed of Bashan, goats, and of the fat of kidneys of wheat. Now watch, and thou drinkest the pure blood of the grape. The grape is a picture of blood. So in their sacrifices, they're sacrificing, claiming it to be blood. Come with me to Psalm chapter 16. They're making drink offerings. Psalm 16, verse number 14. Their sorrows shall be multiplied that hasteneth after another god. Their drink offerings of blood will I not offer, nor take up their names in my lips. So notice, they're offering drink offerings of blood. So you're looking for a religious system that's doing these things. It begins at Babel. There's a competing god, a competing vain religious system being developed. And in Deuteronomy, I didn't point out when we looked at verse chapter 32, there's a fascinating concept in verse number 17. They sacrifice unto devils, not to God, to gods whom they knew not, to new gods that come up newly. In other words, that original 70 nations in Genesis chapter 11, chapter 10 rather, that were given gods to over them, now they're new ones, new nations, new gods. It's an ever-developing system of counterfeit worship. So Deuteronomy 32, by the way, those verses we read about the rock and stuff, that those verses are actually talking in the context about the future from where we are. Now go with me to the book of Judges, chapter 2. So I use that as a preliminary because I want you to see that what we're dealing with here is a spiritually developed counterfeit. Here's God, he has his nation, and they're going to represent him, and then he turns all the other nations of the earth, the Gentiles, over to the fallen gods, and says, you guys run them and see what that does for you. I'll run Israel, and you'll see what that does when you have me. Here's my portion. The Gentiles are literally turned over to the gods of this world. The gods of this world are run by the God of this world. Satan in 2 Corinthians, Paul calls him, if our gospel hit, is hit to them that lost whom the God of this world, not one of the gods, but the head god of the little g gods. So there's this spiritual battle. There is a spiritual issue going on behind the physical scenes all through the Bible. Judges chapter 2, when Israel goes into the land, after they're in the land, the book of Judges, chapter 2, verse number 11. And the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord. This is the first course of judgment going on here. They did evil in the sight of the Lord and served Balaam. Now, this is why you hear me over and over call it Baal worship. Because he's the top name identified as the top God. And they forsook the Lord, God of their fathers, which brought them out of the land of Egypt, and followed other gods, of the gods of the people that were around about them, and bowed themselves unto them, and provoked the Lord to anger. Now that provocation that starts here ultimately goes over to Ezekiel chapter 8, that image of jealousy that provokes the Lord to cast them into the fifth course of judgment. So he's been patient with them from here till there. And in Ezekiel, he says, okay, my patience, it's over. All your chances are done. But it's starting here by them worshiping these other gods. Verse 13, and they forsook the Lord and served Baal and Ashtaroth. Now, I want you to see that because Ashtaroth, Baal is the male god. Ashtaroth is a female. She's a goddess. So they're literally worshiping a male god who has a consort, his queen, a female goddess. Chapter number 10. Chapter 10, verse number 6. The children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord and served Balaam and Ashtaroth, and the gods of Syria, and the gods of the Zidonians, and the god of Moab. Hold your hand there and come at 1 Kings chapter number 11. 1 Kings chapter 11, verse 5. And Solomon went after Ashtaroth, the goddess of the Zidonians. So not only are they worshiping the gods of Syria and the Zidonians, they're worshiping the goddess. So there's a female deity. Come with me to the book of Jeremiah, chapter 44. Jeremiah, chapter 44. You can stop in chapter 7 if you'd like to on the way over there. Jeremiah 7, verse number 18. The children gathered wood, and the fathers kindled fire. The women kneaded their dough to make cakes to the queen of heaven and poured out drink offerings unto other gods, that they may provoke me to anger. They're pouring out drink offerings and they're doing it to the queen of heaven. Now, by now, maybe you can understand why I'm doing this. You ever seen any of that around us? Where we used to meet over there in Neva, the previous building we were in for 22 years, right around the corner, the queen of heaven had a church named after her. In Chicago in the 20th century. It's there in the 21st century. People say, well, our church is the oldest church. Yeah, at least 750 years before Christ. Actually, 2,000 years before. These things keep showing up. This is why the religious system doesn't like a King James Bible. Okay? Now, go back with me to the book of Judges. And Judges chapter 17. Now, if you're studying through Judges, you realize that when you get to chapter 17, he's going to summarize or review the national social impact of departing from the Lord and worshiping these other gods. In chapter 17, he starts out, there's a man of Ephraim, whose name is Micah. In Micah, he has an interesting, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to, I got to sneeze and might as well get it over with if I can. Because you know me and my sneezing, if I sneeze right in the middle of a sentence, I'll blow Jesse's hair off. Micah one of my dearest friends years ago took some of my videos, and he copied all the sneezes and made a 50-minute video of nothing but me sneezing. And he told me it only took 4 videos to do that. When Tracy Plessinger got married, he and Bonnie, I married them, went up to Pennsylvania and married them. And I preached for him that Sunday. And that Sunday afternoon, one of the men of the church there, you guys know Paula Smith, her dad, he took me on a boat ride. And we go around this big lake, and he says, "Look at this beautiful field of golden flowers." It was goldenrods. By the time we got back, I could hardly breathe. That night, I sneezed so many times while I'm trying to pray, I finally just quit. He could have just used that tape, wouldn't need the other one. But fortunately, I found some stuff that kind of stopped me, but when the chalk gets in my nose, I'm saying all this to try to get it out of my nose, so I'm not going to do it while I'm teaching. Judges chapter 17, verse number 5. The man Micah had a house of gods and made an ephod and a teraphim and consecrated one of his sons who became his priest. In those days there was no king in Israel, but every man did that which was right in his own eyes. So you got a condition like Al Gore said, there's no controlling authority. So everybody's going to do what they want to do. So what they're going to do is they're going to set up their own religious system. And Micah's got a house. He's got a house of God. What do people call the church? If you must whisper, whisper a prayer. You're in the sanctuary of God. Where'd that come from? Whoever made you think a building like this or some church building is a house of God? God only made one house he lived in the earth. It's the temple in Jerusalem and the tabernacle in the wilderness. These people got a house of God. Well, they're trying to counterfeit what God's doing. Then they had an ephod. Now, an ephod is a robe worn by a priest. Go with me over by to 2 Kings chapter 10. The priests have a special garment that they wear. An ephod, it's like a polo shirt. It's the robe that a priest would wear. 2 Kings chapter 10, Jehu is going to exterminate the Baalite priest. 2 Kings 10:19. "Now therefore call unto me all the prophets of Baal, and all his servants, and all his priests. Let none be wanting." So he gathers them all together. Verse number 20, Jehu said, "Proclaim a solemn assembly for Baal." And they proclaimed it. And Jehu went through all Israel and gathered the worshippers of Baal and came so that there was not a man left that came not. And they came into the house of Baal, and the house of Baal was full from one end to the other. And he said unto them that was over the vestry, "Bring forth vestments for all the worshippers of Baal." Vestments, you know, if you go into a standard church building, the entryway, what we call a lobby, what do they call that? They call it the vestry. Because that's where the priest's vestments come. That's the name that's used in religion for the garments of the priest. Come with me to Mark chapter number 12. Mark chapter 12. Where'd that stuff come from? Mark 12, verse 38. Jesus is talking, and he said unto them in his doctrine, "Beware of the scribes, for they love to go in long clothing and love salutations in the market." They like to wear long. Look at these. They're wearing the robes. Micah, he's setting this up. He's dreaming up what to do. What's he doing? He's setting up a vain religious system that winds up corrupting Israel later on. Judges 17:5, a teraphim. That's a little statue. Chapter 18, he talks about being a carved statue. You see somebody wearing around his neck the little statue, the little icon. That's what that is. And he consecrated one of his sons to be his priest. This is my priest. Now, verse number 7, there was a young man. So he's got his little Baal worshiping system going there. He's up in Ephraim. Where should he go worship? He should go worship at the tabernacle. If you look at chapter 18, verse 31, the house of God was in Shiloh. Where should he go? There. But he's not doing it. He's setting him up a little competing religious system in Ephraim, up north. Verse number 7. And there was a young man out of Bethlehem, Judah, of the family of Judah, who was a Levite. Now that's the right guy to have as a priest. Don't set up your own guy, your kid. So here comes a Levite. Now that's going to make his system more legitimate, so watch what he does. The man departed out of the city of Bethlehem, verse 8, to sojourn where he could find a place. So he came to Mount Ephraim to the house of Micah as a sojourner. Micah said unto him, "Whence comest thou?" And he said, "I'm a Levite of Bethlehem, Judah. I go to sojourn where I may find a place." And Micah said unto him, "Dwell with me," now watch, "and be unto me a what? A father. And a priest." You ever heard anybody call a priest father? This guy, and if you look down at verse number 11, the Levite was content to dwell with the man, and the young man was unto him as one of his sons. He's going to take a young guy, the age of his son, and call him father. That's a religious title. That's not talking about his age. Come with me to Matthew 23. Matthew chapter 23. You read just a minute ago about the Sadducees like wear long robes and like the salutations in the marketplace. Matthew 23. Verse number 9. Jesus says, "Call no man your father upon the earth, for one is your father which is in heaven." He's not saying, don't call your daddy father. Verse number 7, the greetings in the marketplace and to be called of men, rabbi, rabbi. "But be not ye called rabbi, for one is your master, even Christ, and all ye are brethren. And call no man father." That's a religious title, like rabbi. Well, who in the world would have thought of calling a priest father? By the way, they still do that. Where they get it from? It's Baal worship. So here's a guy, got a kid, as his priest, my priest, going to call him father, and he's going to go offer the sacrifices for me. Verse 10, Micah said unto him, "Dwell with me, be unto me a father and a priest, and I will give thee 10 shekels of silver for a year and a suit of apparel and thy victuals." If you look at chapter 18, verse number 4, he said unto them, this is the Micah, the priest talking to the Danites, "Thus and thus dealt Micah with me and hath hired me, and I'm his priest." The guy's a hireling. John chapter 10, verse 1. He's doing the work because Micah's, Paul said, I profited in the Jews' religion above many. There's money involved here. Money. Profit. And there's that in religion. Verse 11, and the Levite was content to dwell with a man, and the young man was unto him as one of his sons. And Micah consecrated the priest, and the young man became his priest, and was in the house of Micah. Then said Micah, now know I that the Lord will do me good, seeing I have a Levite to my priest. I got the right guy now. I got the one true church. Then you get in chapter 18, and the Danites, a tribe, comes in. And they meet, I won't read it all, but they come in, and they say to the priest, said, who are you and what are you doing? And he says, I'm Micah's pastor, I'm his priest, and I'm doing thus and so with him. And they come back to him, and they say, you come down to verse number, oh, 18, try that one. These went into Micah's house and fetched the carved image, the ephod, the teraphim, and the molten image. Then said they unto the priest, then said the priest unto them, what do ye? And they said unto him, hold thy peace, lay thy hand upon thy mouth, go with us, and be a father and a priest, and be to us a father and a priest. Is it better for thee to be a priest under a house of one man, or that thou be a priest under a tribe and a family in Israel? Whoa, what are you going to do? Go pack up, man. We're going to get a bigger ministry. We're going to build us a kingdom. And the priest's heart was glad. And he took the ephod and the teraphim and the graven image and went in the midst of the people. And he goes out. Now he's going to be a priest to the whole tribe of Dan. If you want to see something funny, verse number 22, when they were a good ways from the house of Micah, the men that were in the house of the house near to Micah's house were gathered together and overtook the children of Dan. They cried to the children of Dan, and they turned their faces and said unto Micah, what aileth thee that thou comest with such a company? And he said, you have taken away my gods, which I made, and the priest, and you've gone away, and what have I more? You got all my stuff. I got nothing left. That's why he calls it vanities. Because there's no reality in it at all. It's just a bunch of false stuff. And when you lose your stuff, you got nothing left. Now you come down to verse number 30. And the children of Dan. The tribe of Dan is where Baal worship gets its first foothold in the nation Israel. You're going to literally get a stronghold in the land. What Satan's after is to get a stronghold, a seat of rebellion in place in the land. It's going to be up in the northern tribes. You've got a full-time vain religious system and operation and establishing a stronghold in the land, and it's going to be a gateway for the future man of sin, the king of the north. Jonathan, the son of Gershom, the son of Manasseh, he and his sons were priests to the tribe of Dan until the day of the captivity of the land. So this thing goes from here all the way through. And they set them up Micah's graven image, which he made all the time that the house of God was in Shiloh. So now you've got God's house in Shiloh, and you've got this counterfeit religion being set up over here and established in the nation. And you've literally got a full-time church in operation that's going out into all the nations that's a counterfeit. Now, come with me if you go to 1 Kings, and I'm going to stop because, well, time's up. But get this about that, because it's going to starts with Dan. That's in the book of Judges. Then you have Solomon. You have Daniel. You have Saul. Then you have David. Then you have Solomon. 1 Kings chapter 1, chapter 11. Solomon, the son of David, is a good guy to start with, but about halfway through, he turns into, rather than a picture of the son of the true son of David, he turns into a picture of the adversary. Get 1 Kings chapter 11 and 2 Chronicles chapter number 9. 1 Kings 11. But Solomon, but King Solomon loved many strange women. Now that doesn't mean silly, kooky, nutty women. It means foreign women, strangers. We're strangers from the covenants of promise. I'm talking about non-Israelis. He was not supposed to take wives outside of his own nation. The daughter of Pharaoh, the Moabites, Ammonites, so on and so forth. And what did they do? At the end of verse 2, they turned his heart from Jehovah to their gods. End of verse number 3, he had 700 wives, princes, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. Turned him to false gods. They turned him from serving Jehovah to serving all this Baal worship. And it came to pass, verse 4, when Solomon was old, that his wives turned away his heart after other gods. And his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God, as with the father, as was the heart of David his father. For Solomon went after Ashtaroth and the goddess of the Zidonians. He's going after Baal, and he's going to worship the queen of heaven. Verse number 7. Then Solomon built an high place, place of worship, for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, in the hill that is before Jerusalem, right in front of Jerusalem, for Molech, the abomination of the children of Ammon. We'll see next time how they burned their children. You've heard of child dedication, you dedicate kids, christen your kids, have godparents for your kids. That's what they're doing with their sending their kids through the fire of Molech. It's all part of that. But what Solomon does, he sets up high places all over Israel. We'll see next time. The whole land gets to be... He literally sets up a state-sanctioned false religious system. The king, the throne, is setting this stuff up. And you have a state-sponsored Baal worship all through the land. He's worshiping the queen of heaven. You've got this full-blown, vain religious system. So verse number 11, wherefore the Lord said unto Solomon, forasmuch as this is done of thee, and thou hast not kept my covenant and my statutes, which I command thee, I will surely rend the kingdom from thee and will give it to thy servant. That's the statement, Leviticus 26, verse 19, that tells you the second course of judgment is here. So what happens when Solomon does this is sets up that state-sponsored Baal worship. God says the first course of judgment is over, the second one's coming. And what he does in the next chapter is he rends the kingdom from Solomon. He divides the kingdom, separates it. 10 northern tribes, and then the 2 southern tribes. And we'll look at that next time because we're running out of time. Because that's where, from that point on, and by the time you get to Ahab, it isn't just state-sponsored. Now Baal worship becomes the official state religion. God's people have just been completely overthrown with spiritual adultery. And what they're overthrown with is a religious system that has to do with a city, has to do with a woman whose colors are purple and scarlet, whose symbol is a golden cup, who's full of interested in gold, jewels, precious stone, who offers sacrifices, drink offerings of blood. If you we go back over to Jeremiah chapter 44 with the issue about talking about the Queen of Heaven, they have cake offerings and the drink offerings and burn incense to her. Incense, prayer. They're praying to the Queen of Heaven. They're offering mass, the bread, the cup, to the Queen of Heaven. worshiping her. They have houses where God lives. The priests have robes called all the. You see all those things and you say, wow. I see all that stuff around me right now. That's why in your Bible and in history, listen, our forefathers 100 years ago knew these things. They knew who the religious system was that you had to fear. They knew who to stay away from. And they knew who the enemy was. And they understood it. You don't have any of that wisdom today. Since the mid-70s and early 80s, it's just all gone away. Nobody's taught it. That's what got Israel sent into captivity. That's what keeps them there today. And it won't be until the Antichrist when that stuff's destroyed. We live between that, and that system's still out there. And that's, listen, when people want to tell you about fight this issue, fight that issue, fight, that's the big game right there. All the other things that you see that are diversionaries from the big game, that's the big stuff. Okay? All right, well, we'll finish up with that next week. But the rulers of the darkness of this world rule through this. Okay? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord and pass the ammunition when you're talking about this. Father, we thank you tonight for your love and your grace to us and for the opportunity we have to study your word, see things that are in it that are true, that enlighten us to the lives that we live, to how to conduct our lives, how to raise our families, and how to conduct our ministry in ways that are effective for what the real issues are. Father, we pray we wouldn't get diverted into lesser things. We thank you for the privilege of it in Christ's name. Amen. All right, praise the Lord.